Belinda Audio presents an unabridged recording from Quarterly Essay, Australia's leading journal of politics, culture and debate.
Quarterly Essay 32, 2008. American Revolution, The Fall of Wall Street and the Rise of Barack Obama, by Kate Jennings. Read by Marie-Louise Walker. Preface. I've been tasked with writing about the election and the markets in the United States this last year. Writing about the recent past is always difficult, lack of perspective, etc. Writing about the present, one as head-swivelling and gobsmacking as this stretch of time, even worse. Imagine a pot of eels being boiled. Not that I've ever seen eels being boiled, but I'm told that not only do they seethe mightily, as you would expect, but if you turn the heat up too quickly, the eels make heroic leaps for freedom onto the floor. You have to scramble to gather them up and put them back into the pot. Each day of this last year has brought a fresh scramble to understand events. Here in New York, we've seesawed between hope and despair, with anxiety our default position. And the eels are still seething, leaping. American Revolution, The Fall of Wall Street and the Rise of Barack Obama, by Kate Jennings. What were they thinking? On the 1st of January, New York Times columnist Bob Herbert rang in the new year by remembering an old one. It seems impossible that 1968, the most incredible year of a most incredible decade, was 40 years ago. One of the astonishing things about 1968 was how quickly each shocking, conscious-altering event succeeded the last, leaving no time for people to reorient themselves. Like this past year, 1968 was a presidential election year, and the country was in the midst of an unpopular, polarizing war. The North Vietnamese launched the Tet Offensive late in January, small people in pyjamas dramatically and successfully challenging the might of the US armed forces, and President Johnson found himself similarly challenged by Eugene McCarthy, a cerebral senator from Minnesota, who wanted to negotiate the end of the war. When McCarthy won 42% of the New Hampshire primary vote, the nation became as electrified as it has been by Barack Obama. Bobby Kennedy decided to jump into the race, and a traumatized Johnson abandoned it. As Herbert wrote, "Euphoria reigned among young people, and those opposed to the war, and those who believed that people of ordinary goodwill could change the world." The euphoria lasted 4 days. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated. In reaction, riots roiled the country, whole neighborhoods burned, and then Bobby Kennedy was murdered. By the tiniest of margins, Richard Nixon and Spiro Agnew won the general elections. A transformative year, unsettlingly similar to 2008, when young people and people of ordinary goodwill again believed they could change, if not the world, then the United States. In Herbert's opinion, hope died with the bullet that killed RFK. But in my 3 decades here, I've always found Americans to be the most optimistic of people. That is, until the Bush administration came to power and set about systematically abusing its executive authority. Apart from the obvious, engaging in 2 wars, in the process of bankrupting the country morally as well as financially, the Bush administration told so many flat-out lies, deregulated so many industries, fired so many experienced people from government agencies, made so many end runs around the Constitution, destroyed so many checks and balances, ignored so many rules of law, that opponents didn't know where to start fighting the good fight. If the Supreme Court could not make the administration adhere to the Geneva Convention and stop practicing torture, what chance did we have of addressing any number of gross illegalities and inequities? Instead, we sank into despair. The country's best impulses were traduced. All of this was done deliberately. As an epigraph to his damning book, The Wrecking Crew, Thomas Frank uses a quote from muckraker journalist Lincoln Steffen's 1931 autobiography. In it, a federal politician describes how he and his colleagues piled on the harm and outrage rather than perpetrating a single injustice that would be pounced on and set straight. Said the politician of this diabolic strategy, "We know that public despair is possible, and that is good for politics." The kind of immoral carpetbagger, screw-you politics that Vice President Dick Cheney made into an art form. I've asked friends who lived through the Nixon era, known for perfidy, whether these last 8 years were worse. "Much worse," they always replied. "Always on their minds, always intruding." However, when I mentioned the similarity of this year to 1968, they were surprised. Then again, they were preoccupied with making sense of events, racked with worry that a Democrat wouldn't be voted into the White House on the 4th of November, and we couldn't begin undoing the harm and outrage. And no one ever wants to dwell on assassination, although those dark thoughts emerged, most especially when we observed Barack Obama surrounded tightly by Secret Servicemen in a formation that brought to mind the Praetorian Guard. On the 1st of January 2008, an article in the New York Times was headed, "What if Iowa settles nothing for Democrats?" It referred to the primary vote just 2 days away. Another article noted that sales of previously owned homes had nudged up in December 2007, but not enough to improve the broader picture of record high foreclosures and harder to get credit. Detroit was worried, but would be fine if gas prices came down. A business writer began a piece with this sentence: "Like baseball or the weather, the economy can be a difficult thing to predict." He went on to say how surprised everyone was in 2007 to see the subprime housing crisis spread to the financial sector. For the basketball fans among us, a rhetorical question was asked on the sports page: could it get worse for the Knicks? Amazingly, yes. As we know, Iowa didn't settle anything for the Democrats. The price of oil soared, and Detroit, myopically dependent on SUV gas guzzlers, found itself more in trouble than ever before. Given a shove by the subprime crisis, the shadow banking system, a teetering pyramid of trillions of dollars worth of unregulated derivatives, collapsed. The credit market seized, and the US economy fell off a cliff. Actually, as more than one commentator noted, at first it pedaled furiously in midair like Wile E. Coyote, and then fell like a stone. Other countries followed suit. Global financial markets equals global financial crisis. All of which was foretold by a number of financial experts not enthralled to former Federal Reserve Chief Alan Greenspan and the free markets. And the Knicks went from abysmal to putridly abysmal until the Dolans, owners of the team, finally fired coach Isaiah Thomas, a man who could give lessons on arrogance to investment bankers. Just like the US economy, it will take years to rebuild the Knicks. When things can't continue, they stop. A piece of sports wisdom which could be the epitaph for 2008. Barack Obama won Iowa, thoroughly upsetting the assumption that Hillary Clinton would become the nominee because Obama, although talented, was too young, too inexperienced. His time would come. He then lost in New Hampshire to Clinton. And we started on what Jon Stewart on the Comedy Channel's The Daily Show called the long, flat, seemingly endless baton death march to the White House. Obama triumphed. But not before friends fell out and spouses shouted at each other over the candidates' respective merits. Not so civil war. The US election season was turned over, tilled, ploughed, excavated, bulldozed by pundits until all that was left was dust. As the daily emails from the Obama campaign reminded me, we went at it for 22 months. Everyone was having a say, and not without cause. First, a woman and a black man running against each other for the Democratic nomination for the President of the United States. And then the black guy, the young black guy, triumphing to go up against the old white guy, John McCain. Who would have thought? In New York, we all became political junkies, the cabbie, the doorman, the sushi maker, and we shook our heads more than once that after all these years of waiting, Democrats had both a woman and an African-American running. I voted for Hillary Clinton in the primaries. She is an extraordinary woman and would have made an excellent president. I love Bill Clinton too, even though he broke our hearts when he couldn't keep it zipped back when he was president, knowing full well that Republicans would set on him like jackals if they got a whiff of sexual shenanigans. He self-immolated, destroyed his presidency and our hopes. And then, during the 2008 primaries, he went ape, ego in full throttle, unable to control his feelings about Obama taking his place in the spotlight. If Hillary had won, what would she have done with Bill? Sent him to the North Pole in the hope that his temper would cool and his you-know-what would freeze and drop off? I changed my allegiance to Obama when I heard him give his race speech, A More Perfect Union, in Philadelphia. One of my trades is speechwriting. I learnt it on Wall Street from the best, ex-Republican Party operatives. I am in complete awe of that speech because it contained much more than the usual pap about hope, the obligatory lines about race. Obama even quoted Faulkner. The past isn't dead and buried. In fact, it isn't even past. He might only be 47 years old, but anyone smart enough to give that speech will be smart enough to surround himself with people who won't truck in conventional wisdom. Also, he is not beholden to interest groups in the way that time-serving polls inevitably are. And Hillary Clinton, for all her smarts, made a huge mistake, running a 20th-century top-down status quo campaign in the 21st century. She ignored what Howard Dean had already discovered in 2004. The internet is a potent viral funding tool. It's also a matchless way to energize a vast grassroots voting base. Did they sleep through the 2003-2004 election cycle? Asked one of Howard Dean's advisers. What was Clinton thinking in dismissing Dean's pioneering internet fundraising effort? For that matter, what was New York State's Governor Eliot Spitzer thinking when he crossed state lines to have sex with a prostitute, allowing investigators to wiretap his phone calls? We'd hoped that Spitzer, who successfully took on the banks and the insurance companies when he was Attorney General, would be able to reform our state government, one of the most corrupt in the nation. Instead, he is spending his days seeing a marriage counsellor and running his family's real estate company. What was John Edwards, who would have made a great Secretary of Labor in an Obama administration, thinking when he had an affair with a campaign worker? Which he excused by saying it happened when his wife was in remission from cancer. Bizarrely, he finished his mea culpa by telling us not to blame his family for his behaviour. Honey, you screwed up all by yourself, but you also screwed with our good faith in running as a presidential nominee. What was Christopher Dodd, another shining Democratic Party presidential hopeful, thinking when he allowed himself to be put on the VIP list at mortgage lender Countrywide Financial? Now he's stonewalling, denying any wrongdoing. I never sought any special treatment. I never was offered any special treatment. What was John McCain thinking when he chose someone as blatantly unqualified as Sarah Palin as his running mate? And what were banking CEOs thinking when they allowed their proprietary trading desks to go hog wild with credit default swaps? Cold dog shit, as one trader called them. I could go on. Equal opportunity, non-partisan, meritocratic arrogance. Here comes everybody. I want to digress here, with purpose, by bringing up Clay Shirky. He has written a book called Here Comes Everybody, The Power of Organizing Without Organizations, which a techie friend, Dean, thrust upon me. I tried very hard to read it, mainly because I hate being thought of as an old fart by know-it-all techies. Over half the book involves an interminable story about a young woman who loses her cell phone and how a movement, so to speak, of her friends and acquaintances was able to retrieve it via social networking sites on the web. Plumbing new depths of inanity, or so I thought. Dean and I argue about the web. He thinks I'm a dinosaur because I like clear sentences and well-constructed arguments. I counter that he can't spell, no zip about punctuation, and wouldn't recognise coherent reasoning if he fell over it. He is full of infectious enthusiasm for the internet and its possibilities. Actually, as am I. But I don't do any social networking on the web, and I rarely read blogs. There are only so many hours in the day. The last book I read about the internet was Andrew Keen's The Cult of the Amateur, How Today's Internet is Killing Our Culture. This book seemed to me to be spot on. Communities on the web are, by and large, disastrously narcissistic, eye-crossingly moronic, and don't give a tinker's damn about piracy or plagiarism or fact-based editing. On these sites, truth is extremely relative. Qualms about this vast, ever-growing mosh pit of noxious mediocrity are usually shrugged off by web true believers. No problem, they say. The cream will always rise to the top. Doomsayers like Andrew Keen and myself think it's impossible for cream to rise when communication channels are clogged with half-baked opinions, illiterate rants, and skateboarding dogs. Okay, that's the downside of Here Comes Everybody. The barbarian hordes, punctuation cretins. Still, I wanted to understand this shirky fellow. He's the bright boy of the moment. So I watched a video of a seminar on the future of the internet where Shirky was a participant. Lots of preening. We're talking young Turks here, very pleased with themselves, but interesting nonetheless. Shirky argued that because of the web, we are experiencing an enormous cognitive...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.